in Pascal's triangle, what is the greatest common factor, I think, of all the numbers excluding the ones in any row of Pascal's triangle? So, you know, the one row is you have 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 3, 1. So, okay, and then 1, 4, 6, 4, 1, right?
Yes.
Okay, I guess we can show Pascal's triangle.
Yeah, I'm just going to.
Okay. So for that, for the first row, okay, we exclude the one, so you can ignore that first row. The second row, you have 1, 2, 1. So you exclude the one, so all you have is 2. So, and I guess I can annotate, right? So for draw, so for this row, the greatest common factor would be 2 because we're excluding the ones, okay?
Right.
For this row, we only have 3s. So the greatest common factor is 3. Now, this row starts getting more interesting. So we have 4 and a 6. So if the greatest common factor of these, the thing that they both have in common?
Is 2.
Is 2, okay?
Right.
Okay. And for this row?
It's 5.
Yeah. Okay.
And for this row, for the next row, we're stuck.
Yeah, so maybe it's just 1, right?
Just 1.
Okay.
Wow, that's interesting.
Okay, and so for this row, anyway, so I was given this problem, and yeah. I was told, what is it, you know, I mean, you can compute it. This is a problem. This is a type of problem that I really like because it's computational, but then it involves a little bit more. So this is great. So in this one, it looks like it's 7, right?
Yeah.
So then it's saying, like, do you know what the nth row is? Can you say? Now, if you study enough rows, and I think when I was at some point, I wrote a computer program, so I had lots of numbers, you know, so I figured it out. So, you know, in this row for 8, it looks like it's, is it 2?
2, yeah.
Okay, 2. And for this one, it looks like it's
3.
Okay, 3. Okay, so maybe if you study enough, you can see some pattern. You know, I don't want to give it away. I'll leave it. But so I found, you know, because I looked at enough, that I figured out what it was. So then it was like how to prove my conjecture. Nobody else bid on it, but it's like a nice mathematical shirt. But it did have a hole and it wrote about the hole. So what did I do with the hole? So there was a little hole right here. So I put a button on it. And like,
you can't tell.
So, you know, so other people might not have liked the shirt, but so it's kind of an asymmetric shirt. So it has a button in a weird place. I didn't like, and I still don't like working under pressure. When I'm assigned something, I work on it right away. So then the deadline is far off. And I don't like working when the deadline is close. I make more mistakes. I get flustered thinking the deadline is near. I don't work well under pressure. So that was kind of a pressure situation. And I like playing around and I like trying various things and then putting the page aside and then starting with a fresh sheet of paper and starting the problem all over again and saying, okay, I know something about the problem now. Let me put down the things that I kind of know. And usually the fresh piece of paper, you know, helps me. When I feel that I know the answer or that I know a way to get the answer, then I'm a little bit uncomfortable because I think they should be doing it that way, you know, the way that I know. So I really much prefer when I don't know the way to solve a problem. So then my next memory is 10th grade. And I was kind of an outspoken student. So I would say things in class. So, one time the teacher said to me, there was a student teacher from Stanford teaching the class. And the teacher said, so you want to teach the class? And so I said, yes. So he said, okay. So then after class, he came up to me and he said, okay, you can teach the class. And this is, you know, I propose that you teach something. I forget what he told me to teach. And he says, well, why don't you teach in 2 weeks and you'll teach this thing? And I said, okay. And so I went and studied whatever he wanted me to teach. And I went over with my father, with Nelson, you know, and I practiced what I was supposed to teach. And the day came that I was teaching. And then he said, okay, Nancy's the teacher today. And I got up to the front of the class and I started teaching it. And I really wasn't conveying the concept very well. And nobody seemed to be following. And he raised his hand. And I thought, oh, phew, you know, he's going to, I call on him and he's going to say, I think you've had enough now. Why don't you sit down? But no, that's not what he said. But that's what I expected him to say. Because I was floundering. You know, I really, you know, it was my first experience teaching really like that. So, and then he talked me through what I was trying to explain. And that was Jim Forthopper. And, you know, here, this is many, many, many years later, I still remember his name. And I'm really impressed that he did that. And I didn't speak out in class as much after that, because I realized just how hard it was to teach. But I didn't realize how hard it was to teach until that time. When I came across a good problem, I would give it to the professor. I would send it to the professor and say, this is a good problem. You might consider putting this on the exam. And I found that professors sometimes would, because exam questions are hard to come up with. So the advantage to it was, one is almost nobody sends questions to their professors. And so the professor would get to know me because this was so different from everybody else. And then secondly, if I gave the question and it appeared on the exam, well, I knew the question in advance. So, and usually I knew the solution because I wouldn't give them a problem that I hadn't worked out myself.
Oh, that's so crafty.
So then I could get a good recommendation when I went to apply for graduate school, and I knew one of the problems. Why is the Julia Robinson Math Festival called Julia Robinson? And it's a bit of a long story. Okay, so it starts, I think, in the 1990s, maybe 1980s, but I'm not sure. It starts before I had a VCR machine. So I would go to the Film Arts Foundation to watch videos because we didn't have a video player. I think video players weren't common at that time. So I would go there and they had a library of films and I would check out films from the library. And I saw these wonderful films. One was called Where the Heart Roams. And another was called The Enchanted Mirror, Where the Heart Roams were about romance novels. The Enchanted Mirror was about television. And these were made by a certain filmmaker called George Chicherie. And so I checked out many films that he had done. I really enjoyed them. And then I saw that the Film Arts Foundation was having a holiday party. I thought I'd go to the holiday party, because I liked films and who was there but George Chicherie. And so I went up to him and I said how much I enjoyed his films. And so he said to me, well, I'm making a new film on a mathematician named Julia Robinson. And he said, would you like to support it? And so he gave me a little flyer about his film and I sent him a check and I was the first person to support his film. And then later on, we decided to make a festival and we were trying to think of a name for the festival. And I didn't want to name it after myself because I figured nobody needs to know my name. So we thought of two women, one being Julia Robinson because of these films and the other being Marjorie Rice, who had solved some tiling problems that were written up in Scientific American. And Julia Robinson had passed away. But Josh Zucker knew her sister, Constance Reed, who had written a lot of books about mathematicians. And so he got in touch with their sister and said, can we name the festival after Julia Robinson? If I hadn't seen that film, if I hadn't gone to the Film Arts Foundation and checked out those films and gone to the little party, who knows whether the festival would have been called Julia Robinson. It probably would have been called Marjorie Rice. Mathematics Festival.